I'm going to make some broad comparisons using the terminologies we've learned between different electricity production technologies. So note the key at the bottom. We're going to look at different energy resources, starting with coal, gas, uranium, and oil, and the relevant conversion technologies for electricity production. Note we're focusing on electricity production, not transportation here. These particular resources all involve a thermal power plant conversion process, and you're using the grid to get the electricity to the end use, which is the demand for homes and businesses. So what you have here, and this is important to recognize, is built-in chemical energy storage. You don't have to invent some perfect energy storage system to help the supply meet the demand. It is built in. You don't have to worry about that. Also, the resource is decoupled from the conversion process. You could burn where you are pulling it out of the ground, but in most cases, you're transporting it. I know when I lived in Georgia, they shipped in their coal from Wyoming, and think about Alaska or Hawaii or other island nations. They ship in a lot of diesel fuel and other resources to meet their energy demands for heating and electricity. So they're decoupled by nature. And the energy conversion process is dispatchable to the grid. I kind of draw a little knob here, so imagine that you can turn that up and down. We'll talk about peaking plants versus baseload plants later, because you can turn some of these plants up and down with varying levels of resistance. Then through the grid to the end use, this is essentially decoupled because the grid is already there. But there are some restrictions on how much energy can flow to certain locations, depending on the congestion on the grid. But more or less, if you're generating electricity onto the grid, it can get to a lot of places. So, moving on to solar and wind. Now, you don't have an inherent ability to store the sun and the wind. You can't go to the beach and capture the wind in a bottle, for example, and bring it home with you. Solar thermal is a little bit different, and I'm not necessarily dwelling on that here, but at least I'll mention that you could heat up a heat transfer medium of some sort with solar thermal energy and it would retain some heat for a while, but that is still through a separate medium, which is still adding an energy storage device to the system. So with photovoltaics or generally a solar thermal power plant, you can either put it on the grid just like you would with a conventional thermal power plant or use it in a distributed generation application. In summary, for solar then, the resource and the conversion are both coupled and co-located. You can't take sunlight from point A to point B without some kind of laser or energy beam. It's got to be converted where you've got it. And it's not dispatchable, with the exception of some solar thermal storage technologies. And if you're putting it on the grid, then this is decoupled, but if you're applying it to a distributed generation application, then the transmission and end use are coupled and co-located. So you would be extracting, converting, and using the resource at the same site in this case. Wind is very similar to solar, where the resource is coupled and co-located to the conversion. And again, it is not dispatchable. There's very little you can do to adjust the output, assuming you're trying to get as much energy out of it as possible for a given wind resource condition. And it can either be connected to the grid or used in a distributed generation application, similar to solar. Now for hydro. There are lots of variations of hydropower conversion. Generally, you're converting potential energy and or kinetic energy, which is built-in energy storage in this case. But here, you've got to convert the energy on site where the resource is. If you have a dam, you do have some dispatchability, although you're restricted to how much rainfall you get and the overall water cycle in terms of how much you can use at any given time. But it is a nice marriage with other renewables because there's typically some ability to dispatch the resource. You may also have pumped storage, which can enhance this dispatchability and help absorb overproduction from other systems on the grid. Hydrokinetic turbines are devices which can be thought of something like putting a wind turbine underwater with flow going both through and around the device. So in this case, you're extracting the kinetic energy out of the water, and there really isn't any way to dispatch this. Because these systems are only found where water is, these technologies would likely be connected to the grid, but they could be used for a local distributed application as well. Finally, wave energy is typically composed of potential energy and needs to be extracted where you have the resource. It is generally not dispatchable, with some small exception, and it is generally decoupled to the end use since it is offshore and would likely be connected to the grid. So overall, there's generally no built-in energy storage with renewables, especially solar and wind, as there is in conventional power systems, and that leads to an entirely different approach to designing and using renewable energy technologies.